We light this candle to remind us of the presence of Christ with us as we worship this morning. And with this, we acknowledge with respect the history, spirituality, and culture of the peoples with whom Treaty 21, the Longwoods Purchase, was signed, and the territory wherein our church resides, and our responsibility as treaty members. We honor the heritage and gifts of both Indigenous and Métis people. Through another raining morning we came, with hopes and dreams, the wounds and sorrows of all our lives. We bring them to this time of worship, trusting that here there will be a healing prayer and a word of grace, and to open our lives to the presence of God as we sing hymn number 506, Take My Life and Let It Be. With the word of hope. By your Spirit, move among us through the words we speak, the songs we sing, the thoughts we hold. May we celebrate your presence as we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. I have a book that fits the message I have today perfectly. I will say that one year in one of my churches, I had laryngitis, so I made one of the guys read it, and he couldn't keep a straight face. It's not that funny, I just think he found himself doing it. But anyone who want to come and... Well, no. No, somebody wants to read it before me. There are kids.
It's Cheer Up Chicken. Are you familiar with Cheer Up Chicken?
Gregory was an old man. He lived all by himself in the forest, with only the foxes and the bears for his companions. But he was not lonely, for he spent his days praying and tending his tiny garden and growing close to God and the world that God had made. And so it was that he grew wise, and the people who lived in the city would travel for days to find him and talk with him and discover the answers to the mysteries of life. Father Gregory, said a visitor one day, you are so thin and frail. Why, I can count the bones through your skin. Take this gift, I beg you, it will do you good. And the man handed Gregory a chicken. What a wonderful surprise, Gregory exclaimed. Thank you so much for this generous gift. Then he put the chicken on the ground and went back to his prayers. When the time came for dinner, Gregory looked at the chicken, and the chicken looked at him. Gregory dreamed of how good that chicken would taste, cooked with onions and a few small carrots. The chicken dreamed of how good it would be to gobble down a few bits of grain. But before either of the dreams could come true, Gregory dreamed another dream. He dreamed of a friend, a young tinker who had been ill recently. Surely he needed the chicken more than Gregory. So right then and there, Gregory tucked the chicken under his arm and set off to find his friend. He walked all night and half the next day. The chicken had never been so frightened. Cheer up, chicken, Gregory smiled. No harm will come to us. And the old man was right. The foxes and the bears paid him no heed, and the sun shone cheerfully through the branches. At last he knocked on his friend's front door. Ka-choo, sneezed the tinker. Come in. I cannot stay, Gregory apologized, but I thought this might help you through your illness. And he handed the chicken to the tinker. What a thoughtful thing to do, the tinker sniffled. Thank you so much for your kindness. Then he put the chicken on the floor and went back to bed. When the time came for dinner, the tinker looked at the chicken and the chicken looked at him. The tinker dreamed of how nice the chicken would taste boiled down to a rich, steamy broth. The chicken dreamed of how nice it would be to be scratched around in the ground again. But before either of their dreams could come true, the tinker dreamed another dream. He dreamed of a girl far off in the city whose little dog had died. That child is lonely, he thought. She misses her little dog. Surely she could use the chicken more than me. So right then and there, the tinker tucked the chicken under his arm, gave his nose a good blow, and set off for the city. He walked for one day, for 2 days, for 3 days, sneezing and coughing all the way. The chicken had never been so bored. Cheer up, chicken, the tinker sniffled. We'll soon be there. At last, the tinker knocked on the little girl's door. Ka-choo! I'm sorry to disturb you. I mended some pots for your parents recently. They told me about your little dog. I hope this will help. And he handed the chicken to the girl. A chicken, the little girl shouted. A chicken of my very own. I will love her and take care of her always. Thank you so much. Then she put the chicken on the floor and ran to tell her mother. When she got back, she looked at the chicken, and the chicken looked at her. The little girl dreamed of how wonderful it would be to hug the chicken and take it for walks and teach it to do little tricks. The chicken dreamed how wonderful it would be to sit on a nest of eggs and raise a little family. Before either of the dreams could come true, the little girl dreamed another dream. She dreamed of a poor beggar woman she had seen in the street that day. That woman had no food or friends, she thought. This chicken could keep her company and give her eggs every day. So right then and there, she put a ribbon around the chicken's neck and two bows on its leg and set off to give her beautiful bird to the beggar woman. The chicken had never been so embarrassed. Cheer up, chicken, the little girl smiled. There's somebody I want you to meet. They walked down wide streets and narrow alleys, through crowded markets and empty squares. At last, the little girl found the woman sleeping in a heap against a tall, dark wall. Wake up, the little girl called. Wake up, please. The beggar woman grunted and shook and snored, and then she gave the girl a drowsy stare. "Here," said the little girl. "I thought you might like this," and she handed the chicken to the woman. "Why, thank you," yawned the woman. "No one has ever given me a gift as beautiful as this before." And her sweet, sleepy smile made the little girl glad. And the beggar woman put the chicken on the ground, tied the ribbon to her belt, and fell right back to sleep. When she awoke, the woman looked at the chicken, and the chicken looked at her. The woman dreamed of what she could get by trading the chicken at the market. The chicken dreamed of farms and fields and wide open spaces. But before either of these dreams could come true, the beggar woman dreamed another dream. She dreamed of a man who had helped her once many years ago. Perhaps, she thought, he could use the chicken even more than me. So right then and there, she tucked the chicken under her arm, hitched a ride on a peddler's wagon, and set off to find her old friend. The ride was bumpy, the ride was rough. The chicken had never been so thrown about. "Cheer up, chicken," the woman grinned. "You soon have a brand new home." At last they arrived. The beggar woman slid off the wagon and hurried to her old friend's house. "Well, there you are," she said. "It's good to see you after all these years. But how you've changed. Maybe this will fatten you up." And she handed the chicken to Gregory. "What a wonderful surprise," Gregory grinned. "It is good to see you too, and to be the object of your generosity." And he bid farewell to the woman, but he did not put the chicken on the ground. No, Gregory looked at the chicken long and hard, and the chicken looked at Gregory. "We've met before, my friend, haven't we?" said the old man. The chicken said nothing, of course, but she couldn't help wondering what would happen now. "Someone gave you to me, I gave you to the tinker, here you are back again, and only you know how many travelers there have been in between. I say it's time for your traveling to end." At those words, the chicken dreamed an awful dream, a dream of gravy and carrots and stew. But before her dream could come true, Gregory opened his door and shooed her out into the garden. "Cheer up, chicken," he said. "We shall spend what's left of our days together scratching around in this tiny garden." And so it was that each one gave, each one received, and all were blessed, and no more, but most especially the chicken. I believe there's Sunday school. Ready to sing "Long Ago and Far Away," which is number 195 in our voices. Thank you. the gospel reading, we are given an early story of Jesus as he begins his ministry. They portray him as a man who speaks with authority and has the voice of a healer, one whose word can drive out demons. So reading from the Gospel of Mark. Is somebody reading from the Gospel of Mark? Yes?
The man with the unclean spirit. He went to Capernaum, and when the Sabbath came, he entered the synagogue and taught. They were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as the scribes. Just then there was in the synagogue a man with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, "What have you to do with Jesus? What have you to do with us, Jesus of Nazareth? Have you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." But Jesus rebuked him, saying, "Be silent and come out of him." And the unclean spirit, throwing him into convulsions and crying with a loud voice, came out of him. They were all amazed, and they kept on asking one another, "What is this? A new teaching with authority. He commands even the unclean spirits, and they obey him." At once his fame began to spread throughout the surrounding region of Galilee.
Thank you. Redemption to your people.
You created your covenant forever, holy and awesome is your name.
Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
The fear of God is the beginning of wisdom.
In this reading from 1 Corinthians, Paul is once again addressing a fight that the church is having. We seem to have started the tradition of church fights rather early. Here the argument is over the eating of meats, as with all of Paul's letters. His answers get to be a little convoluted, at least for those of us who are listening with 20th century ears. However, reading from the book of Corinthians, we hear the words of Paul.
Now concerning food sacrificed to idols, we know that all of us possess knowledge. Knowledge puffs up, but love builds up. Anyone who claims to know something does not yet have the necessary knowledge. But anyone who loves God is known by him. Hence, as to the eating of food offered to idols, we know that no idol in the world really exists, and that there is no God but one. Indeed, even though there may be so-called gods in heaven or on earth, as in fact there are many gods and many lords, yet for us there is one God, the Father, from whom all things and for whom we exist. The one and one Lord, Jesus Christ, through whom all things are, and for whom are all things, and through whom we exist. It is not everyone, however, who has this knowledge, since some have become so accustomed to idols until now that they think of the food they are eating as food offered to an idol, and their conscience, being weak, is defiled. Food will not bring us close to God. We are no worse off if we do not eat, and no better off if we do. But take care that this liberty of yours does not somehow become a stumbling block to the weak. For if others see you, who possess knowledge, eating in the temple of an idol, might they not, since their conscience is weak, be encouraged to the point of eating food sacrificed to idols? So by your knowledge, those weak believers for whom Christ has died are destroyed. But when you thus sin against members of your family and wound their conscience, when it is weak, you sin against Christ.
Thank you. The United Church of Canada was founded in 1925 with the union of the Congregational Union Churches from Ontario, Quebec, and the Prairie Provinces, the Methodist Church, and parts of the Presbyterian Church in Canada. Later joined by the Evangelical United Brethren Church. If you look at the crest of the United Church, you see the burning bush for the Presbyterian Church. It refers to the bush that burned and was not consumed and symbolizes the indestructibility of the church. The Open Bible represents the congregational churches with their emphasis upon God's truth that makes people free through the Word of God. And the dove, which is emblematic of the Holy Spirit, whose transforming power has been a distinctive mark of Methodism. Here, our heritage is one of evangelical zeal, concern for human redemption, warmth of Christian fellowship, the testimony of spiritual experience, and the ministry of sacred song. Aside from these descriptions given by the United Church website, which is where I got those words, is my learned experience of churches. I've preached a number of different churches, and according to my mother, who is preaching even more. Traditionally, the United Churches that were derived from the Presbyterian tradition tended to be more proper, more caring about rules and regulations and how things should be, and their building designs tended to be shoebox, square, long, rectangular, with the precisely placed pews. I don't know that much about congregational churches, but my family and my experience is primarily with the Methodist tradition. It's the strongest one that my family was involved with, although the United Church, I guess, was where my family was, but in any case. The church sanctuary is often a circular motif. You guys are Methodist, by the way, or at least your churches. People would sit with a sense of community and belonging. There was often built into the design a space for Sunday school rooms. But probably what was more important than the design of the building was that the fact that Methodist churches could sing, as someone was telling me on Wednesday. Small notes of distinctions for the Methodist church. They had women preachers back in the 1800s. They were leaders of the temperance movement. They took a stand against slavery, and they endorsed a simple lifestyle. One of the primary motivations for how the Methodists approach their life and faith comes from Paul's letter that we just read part of. First, I think I need to explain something about idol meats, which were mentioned. There were different types of sacrifice in that time. The one we're most familiar with from the Bible is burnt offerings on an altar to God. But to mark a special occasion, or just to give a gift of significance, the temple could be given an animal for sacrifice or not, or other produce that wouldn't necessarily become ashes. A lot of times that's what the temple priests would be able to eat. In religious ceremonies for other gods, the same held true. Not all offerings were for burnt sacrifice, and some ritual feasts were composed mainly of the meat that had been given for sacrifice to God. For a large number of people, this would be the only time that they actually had meat. If you were a peasant farmer, you wouldn't be sacrificing your one milk cow so you get a gross beef, because then there's no more milk. Even if wealthier folks, you remember stories of the fatted cat, they only eat that on rare, special occasions. All of which brings us to the dilemma of the Corinthians Paul is dealing with. The concern is that for some people to eat the meat from a temple sacrifice would have been a way of re-engaging with their old faith and old faith practices, worshiping gods other than the one God of Israel. For others, it was not a problem, but for Paul, it wasn't a problem unless he was eating sacral meat and somebody else saw him and followed his example. If his eating meat became a problem for someone else, then it was a problem. His example might lead them to eating sacrificial meat and to step away from their newfound faith practices and slide back into their old ones. For the Methodists, this passage became central to their way of thinking. Essentially, you don't put your own desires in front of someone else's needs. The most clearly understood one would be the consumption of alcoholic beverages. You might be perfectly fine with a drink or two, but your friend sitting at the table might not be. They might be a recovering alcoholic or somebody who doesn't deal well when they're drunk. Somebody whose sobriety might be challenged by the presence of alcohol. For Methodists, the use of alcohol, gambling, horse racing, and even playing cards and dancing were slippery slopes, which could lead to another's falling off the wagon, and therefore you didn't do any of the things that their failure would become yours as well. There are remnants of that Methodist tradition in our faith traditions of the United Church. For example, we serve grape juice instead of wine for our communion. And more recently, we've become even more conclusive with churches that have added gluten-free options and have included children at the table. We might consider examples of this as common sense and common courtesy. So you're hosting a neighborhood feast which includes a Jewish friend of yours. You have no idea whether they're Orthodox in their daily practice, but you're certainly not going to offer ham. You might even go so far as to ask all guests, including them, about dietary restrictions, so you know what they will not eat. Or you have a friend who has struggled in the past with gambling, so your boys' night out is no longer a night for poker or going to the races. Instead, you have dinner at a local restaurant, not a sports bar. Or your aunt is a recovering alcoholic who has recently achieved a small period of sobriety, so you serve non-alcoholic beverages at your holiday gathering and watch the game with soft drinks instead of beer. In the Methodist tradition, it is so much more than just common courtesy. It is deeply held belief. You don't put yourself and your desires first. You care about the other person enough that you set aside the care and your wants for their needs. The slogan that occurs to me is to live simply so that others may simply live. It takes us back to our Methodist roots, where John Wesley recommended that they dress simply like the Quakers, abstains from alcohol and gambling, and devoutly observe the Sabbath. They embraced Paul's final statement, which boils down to just in case, don't. In In today's secularized world, we are very far from that Methodist thinking. The world tends to think me first, me second, anything left, me again. And so the use of alcohol is a standard with no second thoughts given. While I was out Christmas shopping this year, I noticed a lot of signs and slogans and shirts and mugs, all of which were all about wine being the cure for all manner of things, different things. And the idea of watching a game without a beer in your hand was inconceivable. The skating club that Nathaniel's lessons are through do all of their fundraising through raffle tickets and bingos. I could recoup the fundraising money they required to give them by selling the tickets and working the bingos. Not really an option for me, especially as the United Church minister, and the United Church says clearly no gambling, end of statement. Even the grade 8 at the school that Nathaniel goes to are raising money for their year-end class trip by holding a number of penny sales, with parents and students buying tickets and betting to win the object that they wanted. And of course, with the ever popular 50-50 draws. Have you ever tried when they come knocking at the door selling tickets to just give a donation to their organization? They panic. They can't understand why you would do this. It seems it might have been easier to just buy the tickets and stow them in a drawer or something than try and just give them money without the whole raffle thing in it. And then we arrive at the observance of the Sabbath. Once, it was a holy day. Stores were closed, activities were limited, and it was construed to be a time for reflection, meditation, and rest. Lost that one, haven't we? My mother tells me of a time when the sight of a 5-year-old child swinging on a backyard swing on a Sunday afternoon horrified a member of the congregation. For them, the child was breaking the Sabbath. Now, it is wide open. It's hard to carve out time for worship and holiness on a Sunday morning. How many families have family gatherings on a Sunday, forgetting that Sunday worship time is in the morning and they want you to travel and get there for an early lunch? How many families abandon church and Sunday school for hockey tournaments and baseball pennant races? Stores thronged with shoppers while church sanctuaries echo in silence. I don't mean to criticize. I know the choices are really difficult, and there are times when I find myself shopping on a Sunday. But at that time, at that moment in time, I long for some of the Methodist practices, a simpler world where one could live simply. However, I will say I like to swing, even on a Sunday. Okay, I don't have my last page. There's another page in the sermon, but I don't know what it says. That could be it.
It's not a whole page.
Okay. I can just see it now. You guys have the last page. It's going to be a difficult week ahead for all of us as we hear the words of Scripture and try to apply them to our lives. It's dry January, so maybe that will help some of you. How do we live with a constant awareness of other needs, others' wants, others' desires, especially when we are even to be considering the wants, needs, and desires of people we don't even know? How do we step aside and make room for them in this world, giving up some of what we need and want and desire? It's not simple, it's not easy, but within the love of God, within the teaching of Jesus of Nazareth, within the traditions of our faith, and with the examples of those who have walked before us, we know it can be done. Thanks be to God. Now this is the part that I needed this page for, because as a total sideline to all of this, I'm going to suggest you all go on a treasure hunt. To search through the church building and find all the evidence of Methodist tradition. This was a Methodist church originally. Look for circular aspects to your architecture, the shape of the fish, and the sign of the dove. But first, perhaps, we should continue with our worship, and you can do it after church. Sounds good? Sabbath plan. So we're going to sing a hymn. I'm sure we're going to sing a hymn.
We're going to sing a hymn that makes sense. Put peace into each other's hands.
Number 173 in More Voices.
And I'll try not to lose.
Sunday morning can be rather like a birthday party. When we come to the offering time, we celebrate the gifts of our lives by giving in return a gift to God through the work of this church. The offering will be presented. That they go into the world creating joy and blessing other lives with your love. Amen. God is the one who makes us, loves us, and sustains us. God is the one who makes, loves, and sustains the world. Let us offer ourselves and our world to God in prayer as we sing our call to prayer, Open My Eyes.
Thank you.
one word of grace. You are woven through all of our lives. By your Spirit, move among us. Hear the prayers we offer this day. We pray for this broken world, where hate and anger have become war and violence. Send to these, your people, a spirit of forgiveness and love. Where earth has been destroyed by quake and hurricanes, turning people's lives upside down and inside out, send to these, your people, a spirit of healing and hope. Where people are troubled by the everyday realities of life, send to these people a spirit of courage and strength. To us, your people gathered in this place, send to us a spirit of devotion and faith. We pray this day for those we hold in our hearts and aim to you and in the silence of this moment. Bob, Blake, Jesse, John, Ruth, Minnie, the Doan family, Jeff, Morley, Joyce, Lorraine, Jean, Lori, Bob, Arlene, and Molly. At this time of Holocaust remembrance, we especially remember the lives destroyed by the actions of a people who had lost their way. We pray for the survivors of the Holocaust and for the families of those who were killed. To you, we acknowledge the complicity of our own country, who refused admittance to a boatload seeking refuge. Grant to us forgiveness. Wrap these we name in your love. May fractured lives become whole. May hurts be healed. May sorrow become joy. This we pray, knowing by your Spirit that you are with us each and every day. Amen. And our hymn is number 372, Though I May Speak. Thank you.